Welcome to church today. We are so excited to be joining you wherever you're tuning in from.
Come on.
My name is Praveen.
And my name is Shana. And if it's your first time streaming into church today, we want to give you an extra special shout out and welcome.
Come on.
We hope you make yourself at home and enjoy the event.
Come on, so good. If you are part of our church,
come on.
This is an exciting time of the year. Last week, a lot of our locations gathered together in venues and online locations around the world for our yearly weekend event called The Cave.
And if you haven't heard, there was a big vision released.
Yes.
Co-mission 7227.
Come on, let's
to
go.
To grow to 72 fire starters and campus locations
so
by
good.
2027.
So good.
What an unforgettable weekend.
So
and if
good.
You want to relive or experience some of those moments from Cave 72, we've got just the highlight video for you.
We love the life and wildfire of our church. We can never ever be called boring.
Come on.
Whether you were in the room or streaming online, we hope you feel such a part of what's coming.
Come on. And we are starting a brand new series off the back of Cave 72.
Come on.
It's going to be faith building and a lot of fun. Are you ready for Mission Possible?
As we kick off this brand new series today, Mission Possible Part 1 is going to be just great. We get to hear from our Hereford campus pastor, Geoff, and I want to encourage you to get ready.
Come on.
Stand, cheer, shout, come on at the screen when he comes to share the message.
Let's get expectant for what this event could bring. Maybe it's asking God to give you faith today.
Yeah.
Maybe it's praying for something audacious that you
so
haven't
good.
Prayed before. Or maybe it's jumping in worship for the first time.
Yeah.
Whatever it looks like for you, come take on. A step in trusting God. Let's join the band in worship.
Love. God is for you and he is with you.
Yeah. cast my nets. So I cast my nets on the other side. If you say it, I will do it, you provide. And so I cast my nets on the other side. I see the water stirring, you provide. Come on, let's lift this up. 1, 2, 3. So I cast my nets on the other side. If you say it, I will do it. So I cast my net on the other side. I see the water stirring, you provide. Yeah. 'Cause every good thing that I have seen, well, everyone is a gift to me. This is the lesson that I have learned, yeah. Nothing you give me could ever be earned. Lord, I know that you provide a way for me. Yeah, you provide. And you love won't hide from me. For I have seen that you provide. Yeah, I cast my net, so I cast my net on the other side. If you say it, I will do it, you provide. So I cast my net on the other side. And even when the end does come, it's just a door into a brighter sun. When I reach the other side, for eternity you will provide.
Let's do the shout for that.
Yeah. ahead. Your power is dangerous to the enemy's camp. You still do miracles. You will do what you say. For you're the same God now as you always do. Your spirit breaking out. Your kingdom moving in. Your victory claims the ground. You still do miracles, yeah. You will do what you say. For you're the same God now as you've always been. That's the power of your name. Just a mention makes the way. Giants fall and strongholds break.
Around the world. It is so good to have you with us. Every campus, every location, fire starters, people watching online, it is so good to be kicking off this new series with you, which is Mission Possible. Are you excited? Come on, we are so excited. If you do not know me, my name is Geoff, and I have the immense privilege with my wife, Sian, to lead here in Hereford in the UK. With a bunch of nutters in the house right now. We're going to make a lot of noise. God is doing something incredible here, but he's doing something incredible across the movement. And so we're going to engage with what he's doing today. We're going to engage with his word, and we're going to see what happens. But just quick introduction. I've got a picture of my little family here. There we go. There we are in Cape Town. It's the last time I think I felt sun, which was at Christmas. Because the UK has not figured out yet that it's spring. Although I'm believing we're getting there. And we've got our three handsome lads there. We've got Isaiah on the right, Issa in the middle, and then our newest little addition. I've got a better picture of him. There he is! I know, right? Look at him. It's amazing. And I love that I get to be a dad. I love that I get to go on this journey of parenting and fatherhood and seeing them grow up and raising them to be little disciples, you know, teaching them about God. And it is the best thing. But I don't know about you parents, okay? But I feel like in the last 5.5 years, I've learned more about God through parenting than anything else, right? Are you with me, parents? Because it's a joy. It is a joy, absolutely, but it's wild. Especially three boys, right? I mean, the youngest one is actually quite easy. The other two, they have a lot of energy. A lot of energy. I maybe just need to vent a little bit. So I'm going to tell you a story. But one of the things is when we had Ari, our third one, one of the things that can happen with the middle child is he's no longer the baby, right? Issa was now faced with this new little person who gets lots of attention, and he's not the little baby anymore. And sometimes what happens, found this out in real life, is that they can sometimes take a few steps backwards in certain areas of life and things that you thought you had nailed with them before. And then all of a sudden they come up again. You have to go through it all again. Certain process, certain things that they'd learned. And so one of them that he chose to bring back from the grave was potty training. He was quite all right throughout the day, in nursery, at home, in the weekends, he was fine. It was when I got him ready for bed and I put a nappy on him and I get him in his jammies. It's like clockwork. I could guarantee you within the next 3 to 5 minutes, we had a code brown. 100%. And sure enough, it happened. And most of the time, I'd just deal with it. It'd be fine. Okay, he got a bit embarrassed. We'd deal with it. I'd be very gentle with him. Be like, okay, daddy's going to change it. Don't worry. All right, we're not going to let you go to bed like this. That would be a terrible neglect. I'll have a sore bottom. And so this one time, he did not want any of it, right? He did not want to agree with me. And so anything I'd try and communicate with him to say, no, we really need to change your nappy. I can't just leave you for 12 hours like this. This isn't going to work. The house is starting to smell really bad. Okay, I can't live like this. He was not having any of it. And so he's fighting me. And I'm like, okay, I'm going to have to engage here, right? There's a clear weight advantage. I can do this. And so I engage. For anyone who knows the UFC, you know, some Brazilian jiu-jitsu, it's like a mixed martial arts event. There's arms flailing, there's legs flailing, I'm trying to avoid any poo. But I do it. He's cleaned up. He's got, yeah, thank you. I felt quite proud of myself. He's cleaned up and he smells good again, and I've disposed of the dirt, and he should be ready for bed. And he should, you know, in this moment, I'm like, he should feel like this is the way better option, right? It's clean. Smiles okay, you can go to bed, go rest, relax, just concede here, daddy won, okay? No, not at all. I now tipped him over the edge, and I am now having to defend the bin with my life. As this child, this little human, this little person is charging at me, ripping off his fresh nappy, and this bare bottom is coming for me because all he wants to do is get the dirty nappy back. And I'm like, where's the logic, child? What are you doing? This surpasses any level of understanding. I don't understand. And so I'm not going over the edge. I'm starting to pray in tongues. Starting to cast out the spirit of feces. I know there's no such thing, but I'm past it. Now, fast forward 6 months, we are in a good place. We dealt with it. He has broken through. He does not have that issue anymore. Thank the Lord. Thank you, Jesus. My evenings are a little bit more relaxed, okay? And you might be wondering, why are you telling me this? That is a fair question, but I'm going to link this, okay? Just watch me, all right? I've done this before. This is my first rodeo. I'm not here. So, in this season of Mission Possible, right? I believe God is asking us as his people to level up. I believe he's strongly urging us to mature and to grow into new levels, to break through some glass ceilings, to go beyond ourselves of where we're at now, because there's a mission that's ahead of us, and if we don't do it, it's not going to be possible. But because it's supposed to be Mission Possible, we need to level up. Just like Esau had to level up, he had to become the older brother. He had to move past the stage now. Daddy had enough of it. Okay? And so for us, this is a leveling up season, I believe. And when Shani and I took on Hereford in 2018, I think one of our first vision is God dropped this line on my heart, and I've used it ever since. I believe it's key for this season as well. And it's this, it's an internal update for an external impact. God is charging us to become more fruitful, right? He's asking us to extend our reach, to go further than we've ever gone before. That external impact needs to increase. But in order for that to be possible, we need to internally update, right? For all you geeks out there, it's like you got the same equipment. You need a new operating system, a new OS, right? And so we need to level up. And that will make the mission possible. And I love that this series is called Mission Possible, because I think it's perfectly showing us what a life with Jesus and a journey with Jesus is like. Because actually, this is what I believe in our journey with Jesus, is that there are no guarantees. But there is a guaranteed chance. Okay? There's no guarantees, but there is a guaranteed chance. It's possible. It's possible, but sometimes because of our misconceptions, our presumptions, the way we interpret things, the way we think God is going to move, and the expectations we have, God's like, I'm not going to do it that way, right? Most of us will have faced this before. We think God's going to move in this way, and then he does it in a completely other way. And it's the best way. But we wanted this. And so we need to engage with what he wants to do. We need to level up. Our external impact needs to increase, and it's going to become possible. And I could not share this scripture with you, this story from the Bible, okay? If If stories in the Bible were like blood, okay, just go with me on this. This one would be running through our veins as freedom. It's from 1 Samuel 14. It's Jonathan the armor bearer. This is like our type of story. All right, and for anyone who doesn't know his Bible or who doesn't know the stories very well, let me give you a little bit of context. We're at a time where Israel is at war with the Philistines, okay? It's like their arch nemesis. They go through this a few times. And it's like the Joker to their Batman, okay? They're faced often. And so they're at war with them, but they're at a great disadvantage because the Philistine army is massive. They are huge. They have hundreds of thousands, right? Troops, chariots, horses, footmen, everything. The whole shebang. Israel, not so much. They're small now. Even worse than that, they have no weapons. Because the Philistines are in control of the iron and who's making the weapons. And so they have nothing. They have to make do with some farm equipment, which is terrible. The only two people in this whole army to actually have a weapon is the king, King Saul, and his son, Jonathan. Now, King Saul is an interesting character in any way. He wasn't even supposed to be in this place because God was supposed to be the king. But these people were asking for a king, a human king, just like the other nations had. And so God ultimately said, okay, have what you want. Here he is. Deal with the consequence. He was an insecure leader. He disobeyed God. They were living in the consequence, right? This guy is now sitting under a pomegranate tree, not seeing any way out for his people. His army is literally hiding in caves and hiding away because they're so scared. But then you've got Jonathan and his armor bearer. These two are of a different caliber. They're a different character. Jonathan has seen some serious success in battle, and he's done with this. So those two break away from the army without anyone knowing. And they're in this place now. They've got a Philistine outpost at the top of a hill, a very sharp, rocky hill. And this is where we pick up the story, 1 Samuel 14, verse 6 to 7. And he turns to his armor bearer and says, come on, dude. Let's go. Let's go over to the outpost of those uncircumcised men. Perhaps. Maybe. There's no guarantee, but there is a guaranteed chance that the Lord will act in our behalf. Because this is what I know of the Lord. He doesn't need much. Nothing can hinder the Lord from saving, whether by many or by few. Maybe he just needs someone to do something. Maybe we're the two someones to step out, and maybe he'll move for us. But armor bearer, nameless guy, I'd love to know what his name was. I can't guarantee this. And so in our minds, I would be very forgiving and gracious towards the armor bearer if he was like, can you run that past me again, man? Did I hear that? What? Can you just repeat that one more time? The two of us up there? You're the only one with a weapon, man. Like, I know you've had some success, but this is a suicide mission. Like, is there any other way? Can we chat this through a little bit more, right? Let's put a little bit meat on the bones because this is not making sense to me. We'd be like, yeah, that's fair. Yeah. Even if he completely rejected it, I was like, man, Jonathan, man, I think you lost it, bro. I think you've had a bit too much wine. All right, I'm going to pray for you. I'm going to take you home. We're going to sleep on this. Reconfer tomorrow, right? We're not doing this now. That is stupid. We'd be like, yeah, because it's a suicide mission. But this is the armor bearer's response. Many of us know this. Do all that you have in mind. He's like, Jay, right? I'm with you. Right? You had me at perhaps. Go ahead. I'm with you, man. Heart and soul. If you look back, I'll be right there. I've got your back, man. I'm going to go with you and we're going to do this together. And what I love is that these guys were mad, but not because of foolishness, but they were mad enough to see an opportunity and act upon it and be like, all we need is a perhaps. And honestly, in this leveling up season, I'm going to speak to some of you right now. This is where you need to level up. This type of loyalty. Because this armor bearer was willing for his leader to be wrong. He was willing for his leader to get it wrong and for it to cost him his life. He was willing for this guy to lead him into either certain death or certain capture or certain torture. I mean, who knows what they would have done if they would have captured them. And he was willing to be like, but maybe You make the decision, I'm right there with you, heart and soul. And we can throw these things out and we can say these things, but when your leader actually says something and it doesn't turn out like you expect it to be, how many go turn around and say, I knew it. I would have done it this way. I wouldn't have engaged in that way. That cost me too much. That cost us too much, let alone cost me. Are you willing for the decision of your leader to cost you something? Are you willing to go on the journey and whatever outcome it is, not to turn around and blame? Are you willing to go and stand behind and whatever happens, happens, and we own the wins and we own the failures, but we're in it together. We need unity more than ever. We need to level up loyalty, unity. This is some of our internal update. If you're struggling with cynicism right now, with doubt, with pride, with religion, you're gonna have to kick that out this season, because it's gonna hinder your mission possible. It's gonna be mission restricted for you. You're not gonna see it happen. And so let me throw out another story, because they're so awesome. Old Testament stories are amazing. The Joshua and Caleb story, right? Again, if you don't have the context, it's Moses, many of us will have heard of him. He led Israel out of Egypt, out of captivity, and we know they wandered the wilderness for 40 years to ultimately get to the promised land, the land that God had given them, had promised them, had got them out of Egypt for. But actually, early on in their journey, way early, they actually reached the border of this promised land, and Moses sends out 12 spies. Right, for 40 days, they scout out the land to go see and to gather some intel on what's going on there. And they all come back in agreement that this land is amazing. This land is the best land. It is exactly as God has said. It's blessed. It's flowing with milk and honey. It's fruitful. It is so amazing. But 10 of them are like, however, how awesome this land is, it's not going to happen, guys. Because the people living there, they're too fierce. They're gonna eat us for breakfast. We don't stand a chance. And they bring this bad report, even though they've seen it, they've tasted it, they've experienced it. They're like, there's no chance of us ever taking possession of this. So, do you know what, let's back off. And then you've got Joshua and Caleb, the other two of the 12. And they don't just are like, guys, no. This is what Caleb does. This is what he does. He shuts them up. Right? Because he's going to make a statement. He's like, what are you guys talking about? We have to. This is why God led us out of Egypt. Not to just wander around like nomads. No, he wants to give us this land, so we should go up and we should take possession. For we can certainly do it. There's a guaranteed chance because God said so. And so we have to. Now, sadly, the people, they go with the 10. They chose unbelief, they chose distrust. And so the consequence now is that for those 40 days they were in there and experienced the incredible promised land and yet did not value it enough and did not trust God enough for God to move for them, they now have to live in the consequence of wandering the wilderness for 40 years. And we have to ask ourselves the question when it comes to Mission Possible, all right? Is the cost of not doing anything, is the cost of not trying actually going to be greater and heavier than to try and fail? Is the cost of not trying going to be greater than failure? And I put failure in like that, if you can't see it on the screen, it's failure. Because failure is perspective, because the real failure is in not trying. The real failure is in not doing anything. Because actually, if you go on the journey, and some failure is meaning you get some redirection, you get some revelation, you build up some character, some grit, some resilience, you learn some lessons, you bleed a little, okay, but you've learned something, but you can still go again. That's not failure, that's process. That's just like you're not done yet, it's not complete yet, it's still Mission Possible, you need to keep going. God is doing something. And so ultimately, they have to wander the wilderness for 40 years for them to die out. Now their sons and daughters are the ones that are allowed to step in because it cost them everything. They were never allowed to take possession of the promise, not even Moses. So Joshua has to take over. And the only two from the old generation, Joshua and Caleb, they're allowed to go in and take possession. But here's the crazy thing. this is what weighs heavy, I think, is that the sons and daughters were now faced with the fight that their parents had to fight. It was their parents' mission possible, but they never wanted to engage with it, and now it's up to the sons and daughters to take possession of something that they should have inherited and not have to fight for. That's good, right? I know. This is when you know this message isn't from me, this is from God. I am not that clever. But I was thinking about it. I don't want my sons to have to deal with my battles. I want to be able to give them a legacy. Not all my problems that I never faced. I want to give them the promise that God has for our family, that God has for our church. Because they're going to step up and lead at some point. What do you want to give them? Something that's half dead? Or do you want to give them something that's thriving and alive for them to take even further? It is mission possible. It is. And we have to engage with it. There's a scripture that, so if we're talking about the internal update, okay? Because the external impact is going to be dealt with if we internally update. One of the things that I believe for this season that God wants to update within us comes from this scripture that's been on my heart for the past 2 months, and I have not been able to shake it. It's from Matthew 11, verse 12. And we'll read it, and then I'll try and explain it. It says this, from the days of John the Baptist until now, the kingdom of heaven has suffered violence and the violent take it by force. Now, as a young Christian, I came across this verse. I didn't fully understand it. I thought, oh, this doesn't sound good. It doesn't sound great. I'm not quite sure what it means, but that sounds negative to me. But actually, when you start looking at what it means and you actually literally translate the Greek, it starts sounding just a little bit different. It starts sounding like this now. From then, the days of John the Baptist until now, the kingdom of the heavens is taken by violence and the violent claim it. Okay? Now, what is this taken by violence and what are these violent men? Again, what words are used here in Greek? It is so powerful. This is the word for taken by violence. Okay? Biazzo. I almost sounded Italian more than Greek. To use power to forcibly seize, laying hold of something with positive aggressiveness. So when we're talking about this violence, please hear me right. I'm not saying that we're going to go and be harmful to people and hurt people and be violent in that way. This is a posture, a spiritual posture we have to take on. It's to take something by force with positive aggressiveness. Because actually, Christianity sometimes is portrayed as such a soft thing. And yet, when you look at the Lion of Judah, there's nothing soft about him. He's not called the pussycat of Judah. He's called the lion. It took some real aggression for him to pursue the cross. He knew exactly what he was going to face. He was bleeding sweat. Or sweating blood. Not bleeding sweat. Sweating blood. He was in anguish because he knew this was going to be so painful, so difficult, so hard, but he was like, I'm going to aggressively pursue this because my people need a guaranteed chance at forgiveness. If they choose to engage with it, they need to have that opportunity. And so we need to reflect that. I'm just going to go there, but sometimes I'm fed up with the namby-pamby, soft self-help worship that's around, talking about all my problems. I'm like, stop it. Give me some breakout. Give me some songs that are going to stir my spirit, that are going to make me realize who God actually is, who's in authority here, and it's going to help me aggressively pursue something. Because even if you're an introvert like me, and I'm quite mellow, all right? I'm usually quite mellow. Maybe not now. But I'm a relaxed guy. I don't, you know, Dave Thomas lives at this kind of energy level. Dave. I live about here. But here's the thing. If someone tries to ever harm my kids, I can be as introvert and as relaxed as you want, but that moment, you're gonna feel my wrath. And I know that for some of you who've used the excuse of that's not me, if someone's gonna hurt your child or someone you love, you're gonna get aggressive. Because there's something about the injustice and there's a righteous anger that, and this is a good thing. There's some healthy aggression that we're allowed to have. God's an aggressive God because he aggressively loves us. He went to death and took on death for it. So this is what the violent men means then. Let's go there. Violent men, a different word, biastes. Positive assertiveness. Use of the believer living in faith, right? It's about God's inward persuasions. He's persuading us in our spirit, convicting us of something that we need to go and claim, right? He's guiding and empowering us to act forcefully. Forcefully, i.e. fired up by God to act by his revelation. And so when I'm talking about this, I am talking about the internal things. So for some of us who struggle with insecurities, who struggle, let's go back to the cynicism and pride, you know? How about you aggressively pursue humility? How about you get so disgusted with the pride, you get so angry with the state of how things are, and you internally make a switch and say, I'm gonna violently take claim of the humility that God has laid in front of me to possess, because it's a godly thing. And I want my kids to see me able to be humble in a godly way. And I wanna aggressively pursue that, to give them that legacy so they don't have to deal with the same pride issues that they learned from me, with the same cynicism they learned from me and the things I say about our church or our leaders or these people. What if you have a issue with lust or addiction and you start aggressively pursuing purity? Make no excuses. And I'm not saying it's gonna be easy peasy lemon squeezy. I'm saying it's gonna be hard. You're gonna have to engage with some warfare. But you've got it in you because you have the Spirit of God within you. Because this is what the Celts called the Holy Spirit. They called the Holy Spirit the wild goose. It's very hard to catch a wild goose. They go everywhere. They're fast, man. And so there is something about chasing the wild goose. It's an adventure. Yeah, you're going to get hurt sometimes. It's going to hurt a little. It's going to cost you. But actually, the cost that you're going to pay is nothing compared to the cost you're going to pay if you don't. And so to value that and to aggressively pursue, right? It says in Scripture to flee from sin. And it's not just like, oh, look at that. There's temptation. I'm not going to touch it. I'm just going to go here. But just keep looking over my shoulder now and then. What about you aggressively run the other way? How about you stop it and you aggressively and violently pursue what God... If, let's go back to the lust thing. If you make a decision to not have your devices in your bed late at night, and not put yourself in that temptation, and you put them outside somewhere, you lock them up in a box, whatever, aggressively pursue it. Make some clear statements of what it's gonna be like. Put some blocks on there. And the only thing you have by you is the Word of God, and you start aggressively pursuing this Word. And you start aggressively reading of these people who dealt with the same issues like you did. They were real people, Joshua and Caleb, right? Jonathan the armor bearer, they were like you and me. But there's something so inspirational, and you start aggressively taking that on and seeping that in. It's gonna form something strong within you. You're gonna internally update, and your impact is gonna be way greater because you're gonna start living with what you're feeding yourself. How much time do I have left? I don't know. Let's see. What if we aggressively pursued the kingdom together, church? In this season, we're called to go further than ever before. And we can either coast and try and see God do a lot of things for us, but I think he's asking us to engage with him and not just spoon-feed us things, not just solve our problems, but he's asking us to engage in a relationship with him so that he can extract the very beauty and strength and gifting that he's placed within us, the treasure that he's placed within us, so that other souls may be benefited, so that the next generation may be benefited, so that we at the end of our life, whenever that is, we might actually have a story to tell, and we will have no regrets, and we'll have something that we can, when we stand before God, we can be like, God, hey, I failed along the way. I fell a few times, but I never stopped, because you put something in front of me, and I did all I can in my power to aggressively pursue it. Thank you. And hopefully, and I know that in that moment, God is going to be able to say, well done. That's what I wanted. Well done, my son. Well done, my daughter. We went there together. I'm so proud of you. His grace is sufficient. His strength is there. It's within us. And some of us, I know, need healing. Some of us, we feel vulnerable, and that's okay. But if us around you start violently pursuing things, we're going to pull you along with us. We're going to pray for you. Right? In certain moments, how about we aggressively get on our knees and start praying? We aggressively start worshiping. We aggressively start pushing ourselves to the front. Because there's something of our posture that we have to train right now in the leveling up season, because what's coming, we are not able to possess yet. But as we level up, we can take possession. And just like Caleb says, surely we must. Surely we must. And so I want to challenge us, just because this challenges me, because I don't live this out every day. I'm going to be honest with you. But I want to. I want to. And so there's a few questions I'm just going to chuck out at us. And it's these. Take them home with you. Take a picture of it. Write them down, whatever. And then go and bring it in prayer. Chat about it with your spouse. And see, what internal parts of me could compromise the mission? Because here's the deal with Joshua and Caleb. When Joshua then finally took this new generation into the promised land, it wasn't all smooth sailing. They had incredible victory at Jericho in such an unorthodox way. It's like, how did this ever work? But it worked because God was in it. And so the next city that they were supposed to take, which is Ai or Ai, however you want to pronounce it, was a lot smaller, a lot easier to take. They were quite confident. They went for it. They lost. Because they had to reassess something of disobedience and sin that was happening and deal with that so that, again, the mission would become possible. And next time, they were able to take Ai. So we have to assess what could compromise the mission and deal with it. Am I willing to follow even if it could cost me? Not just us, but me personally. Am I willing to follow my leader if he's going to make a decision that's going to cost me dearly? But actually, what we have to gain is so much more valuable. Do I need guarantees, or is a guaranteed chance enough? All it takes is a shot. All it takes is a chance. All it takes is a maybe. And let's see what God does. I'm excited to see what he does. Oh, what an adventure. What do I need to aggressively pursue and take by force? Internally first. And then let's finish on this scripture. Matthew 6:33 says this. But first and most importantly, seek. And the Amplified says this. Aim at, strive after. So you could rephrase it. You could say, but first and most importantly, seek. Or most importantly, aggressively pursue his kingdom and his righteousness. And what does that mean? His way of doing and being right. The attitude and character of God. Let's aggressively pursue the kingdom and the internal things that need leveling up. And then the rest will fall into place. We'll be given as well. You don't have to worry about that bit. Focus on the priority. Aggressively pursue God and his kingdom. Aggressively pursue his holiness. Aggressively pursue his purity. Aggressively pursue the humility. Aggressively pursue the submission. For some of us who are maybe distant from God, it's time to aggressively run home. Don't let it cost you everything. Don't let it cost you like it cost the Israelites. Come home. Violently run home into his arms. There is no condemnation in Christ. He is waiting for you. He's saying, I'm aggressively in love with you. I died for you. Come back. And for some of us who don't know Jesus, know that this is a wild journey. Know that it is going to cost you something, but the things you're going to gain are invaluable. Is that the right word? Yeah? Valuable, invaluable. Sometimes the English language doesn't make sense. But it is going to be so much better because you will have found the very thing you were designed for. A relationship with your God, your creator, your king, your Messiah. Aggressively come to him. Recognize where you're at. Recognize that this is not where you're supposed to be. Recognize that you did make mistakes. And there's this beautiful word in scripture called repentance. It means you acknowledge that. You ask for forgiveness. The cross gives it to you. And then you turn the other way and run towards him. it is available for you today. There's a guaranteed chance for you to step into salvation and hope and vision and life and love and everything that God has. It's the promise. You can take it by force, by submitting to Him. And so I pray, Lord, that you would stir us as a church right now to respond to your word, God, to come before you. And I pray that we'd all seek our hearts. And Lord, that you would point out the things where you want us to level up. And I know that you're a gentle God. I know that if there's 10 things, there's going to be the one thing for now. And you're going to ask us to do that. And then the next one. And then the next one. God, we're on the journey with you. And it is the most exciting journey. Thank you, God, that we get the privilege to walk with you, the King of Kings. Thank you that the Lion of Judah is watching over us and is empowering us and is cheering us on. Thank you that we are not victims, but we are victors. Thank you that we can take possession. And thank you that every day we get up, it's a process. Lord, we don't have to stop until we get to the end. We get to enjoy the blessing of your presence every single day, the blessing of this journey with you. And Father, we get to take others on the journey. Lord, help us to grow as a church and take possession of the promise ahead of us, I pray. And for anyone who is needing to respond to Jesus, whether for the first time or needing to come back, in your locations, people are going to lead you through that moment now. And I pray that you will respond in Jesus' name.
Thank you, Geoff, for that powerful word this morning. Thank you for starting off this series, Mission Possible. Church, let's get ready to go.
Let's go. Guys, thank you so much for joining us today. If you're watching online or you have responded in some way or have any questions, please reach out to us and, you know, get in touch in the comments or email us at hello@freedomchurch.cc. Thank you all for joining us this morning. We'll see you all next week.